Welcome. So today we're going to talk about cryptography and really just kind of put together all the basic building blocks that you see as how cryptography relates to anything in crypto. And there's really four major areas that we want to cover today. We have the encryption, the keys process, hashing, and what digital signatures are. Just so at least we have an understanding that these four components are part of almost any blockchain system, whether it's public, private, that also leads into the cryptocurrency systems. First off, what is cryptography? In essence, what we're trying to do is we're trying to create or send information between two parties. And then also you have to receive that information. Now, you want to make sure that it only goes to the intended parties without allowing somebody from the outside to be able to snoop or look at what those messages are. That's where kind of cryptography came from. In fact, probably one of the most famous examples is from World War II, where we had the Nazis using the Enigma machine, which was used to encode and decode their messages in World War II. And so the people who had the code on the machines could actually decode the message on the other side. Well, what the Allies did then, Alan Turing back in World War II came up with an idea of a Turing machine. And this invention was specifically designed to decode and decrypt the Enigma machine once they figured out some primer that they could figure out the rest of the messages and actually help turn the tide of the war. So that's a really famous example. So now when we were kids, we probably have all done something like this. And so one of the most simple kinds of cryptographies or ciphers really is what they call the Caesar cipher. And this is where you can encrypt by, you know, taking the alphabet, and for every letter you shift one letter over, or you shift five letters over, whatever that is, forward or backward. And you just understand that if I'm shifting five letters over to the right, then whoever's receiving the message understands that key. So that for them to decode, they shift five letters to the left. So that's what a basic cipher encryption is. Great for things that kids can do, but not really something that you could use on the internet. It's way too easy to break. Anybody creating some algorithms could easily break what your encryption and decryption codes are and get to know what your messages are. So not really useful for digital secure transactions. However, we do need to look at how we do things, because the other factor we need to consider is, do we have a symmetric communication system or an asymmetric? Now, for symmetric, that's where we use the same shared secret key both on the sender and the receiver, and then that key is used to encrypt and decrypt. That's very similar to the Caesar cipher we were talking about, where they're related. Now, that actually does get used sometimes in machine-to-machine communication, where you have an encode and then a decode, where it's not so much about security, but it's about compression. So you can compress a message when you encrypt it and then decompress it on the decrypt message so you can spit it out on the other side. So that's still used a lot for those types of applications, but not very good if you're trying to put something across a broad network and you don't want somebody to get access to that shared secret key. So instead, what's used in cryptography and in cryptocurrencies now is asymmetrics. So in this sense, you have what we call a public and a private key. Now, a public key is something that's broadcast. So if I want to send a message to Bob, let's say, I would get Bob's public key, whether it's via some email program or something like that, or messenger program. So I have Bob's public key, so I can encrypt the message using his public key. Now, only Bob can decrypt it with a private key that only Bob has, that nobody else has. Now, the way that works then is then even if somebody can see your public key, you can't get a snooper who's going to go in and be able to decrypt that message because they don't know what your private key is. Versus in the symmetric, if that shared secret key gets out, then you have a way that person can see the whole message and can sometimes even pretend that they're you. So that's kind of a basic difference between those two. So how does Bitcoin do this with a public and private key? Well, it uses a little bit of a different method. Many of the implementations that have been used are from OpenSSL. There's a cryptographic library. You can go to this link and check that out. But it runs a ECDSA. algorithm. And what that does is it uses an electrical curve to map between a private key and a public key. Now, how does this work? Well, the private key is randomly assigned 256-bit number. That's usually formatted into 64 hexadecimal digits. That's kind of the format that most crypto works in. And that's the thing that you need to keep secret. And that's the key that controls what you can and can't do, whether you're going to submit transactions, decrypting things, all sorts of stuff. Now, the public key is derived from that private key. And you can actually generate several public keys from a private key. So, for example, you have a private key address. We'll call that number K. And using the one-way elliptic curve digital signature algorithm, the one we talked about, which you can look at the link if you want to really see how that algorithm operates. You can go and read all about it. And so really, it's that number K times some generator point, which is also randomly picked on this elliptic curve. So the generator point is the point G, and then it goes through these machinations to get to any number times G. So you take the K times the G, and that's how you get the public key. It's going to be whatever that result is for big K, and that's your public key. So that's the general relationship between those two in Bitcoin. Not all of the things use that. Now you guys get to play with this for one of the assignments at bitaddress.org. And what's kind of cool is you can generate both public and private keys, just like we show in the example here. If you notice, this is the 64 hexadecimal number here, and this is also a 64 hexadecimal number down here. One is public and one is private. But to do the assignment, we're going to go to bitaddress.org, so you can check that out. Just to give you a taste of that, it's just kind of fun because they have a little interface where as long as you're moving the mouse, it keeps generating and randomizing. So actually your movements, every little movement I make keeps changing with this generated address. So it lets me do this until I get to 100%, and then it will generate some keys. And this is kind of inefficient, but this is kind of more fun just so that you can see. There it is. All right, so I got to 100%, and now you can see in the format of a Bitcoin address, here is a public key that is shared, and here's the private key. Now, this is the one that you wouldn't share with anybody, and typically, in a lot of implementations, this is kept secret or can be put in something like a paper wallet where it's showed on here. Most people don't use paper wallets anymore. This is kind of like a cold storage where you can put this into a safety deposit boxes and things like that, where it's all printed on one thing. Most people use hardware wallets. But we'll talk about that more when we get to the wallets. Okay, so speaking of wallets, you can have a single wallet, the paper wallet, which is the one I just showed you guys. There's a bulk wallet with multiple wallets on there. And you guys are going to play around with the WIF compressed address. That's also on that website. A brain wallet, which I wouldn't necessarily recommend unless you have like a photographic memory, because it actually expects you to memorize something to have that in there. And remember, the stuff that you're generating here, we're not going to use these for actual transactions. This is just for fun, so you understand the relationship between those two. The ones I do recommend, and this is recommended in the syllabus for this class too, is to get a hardware wallet. Trezor and the Nano Ledger S seem to be the market leaders in this as far as security and being and fairly safe. And the way this works is that you really store transactions on the blockchain, and your private keys in your hardware wallet so that you can always access your transactions and your addresses from that. And so the way it kind of protects you is instead of just having everything on a computer program where if somebody were to hack that program, they can get access to your private keys. Here, you have to have not only access to the network via a computer or a phone, but also you have to have the hardware wallet that you connect up and something that you do on your hardware wallet itself, whether you're putting in a passcode, whether you're putting in a PIN, all those kinds of things are done on the piece of hardware itself. So it's something you have to remember and something you have. So it's kind of at least a stronger two-fault tolerance system. And the good thing about hardware wallets like this as well is, let's say you lose one, as long as you have securely kept, and it's usually like a 24-word code that has a sequence to it, that's something you keep in a PO box and safes and things like that. You can always buy another one, even if this gets crushed. Let's say you run over it with your truck. You can actually buy another one, and then you can reconstitute all of the access to all your blockchain holdings on the new one using that 24-key code. But the limit there is that 24-key code. And so you always hear horror stories about people losing a whole bunch of money in cryptos because they never remembered that or lost their... Okay, moving on, let's talk a little bit about hashing, because this is another component that is critical to not only Bitcoin, but to a lot of other cryptocurrencies and also other private blockchains as well. A hash function essentially is an algorithm that converts some input data into a digest, or fingerprints, in other words, or hash is the short term. Really what it is, it's a unique short number that maps to anything. It really could be anything. It could be an entire file that you've encoded into this little number. It could be, so you think about it, it's almost like compression, but it doesn't retain all the data. It's just a unique hash of that data. So don't confuse that. It's not compression. It's not the same thing. At any rate, so what you have then is, whether it's a file, a manuscript, some text, or a set of transactions, you really compress that down into a knowable hash. And that hash is deterministic. So in other words, if I do this over and over again, let's say I've got a file and I don't change the file at all. Every time I use a hash function on that file, I will get the same exact number every time. That's what makes it deterministic, or one way. However, it's not reversible. You can't then go from the hash back to the original file. In that sense, that's where it's not like reversible compression, where you can unwind it and get back to the original. So in this one way component is important to us, because then it makes it very applicable to something that you want immutable, aka like a blockchain of transactions, where you want that transaction chain to be accurate and not changeable. That's a part of what the intent of the whole hash function in Bitcoin and some others do for us. Okay, so I put an example here. So maybe our input is a set of text. How hot is the oven? A simple hash could be, we take the second character of each data message. Again, this is not something you would do in the digital space at all. So how hot is the oven? Well, if we're taking the second character of the data message, it's just going to be the O in how. And so the O would represent the hash. It is deterministic one way, not reversible. However, I could have said just as likely that, well, you know what? I want to take the character where hot is. So 1, 2, 3, space is 4, 5, 6. So I could have said, I want the sixth character, and I get the same thing. It's not unique. So that's a little bit different. That's where this would break down and a basic hash function wouldn't work. So what kind of hash function properties do we need if we're going to go into the cryptographic world? Well, it needs to be able to compute the hash quickly. So what we call a fast forward computation time. We don't want something that's going to have to churn and churn to determine what the hash is. So it has to be fast, deterministic, which we already looked at just a second ago. In other words, the result is always the same with the same input. It has to not be feasible to go backwards and generate the original message from the hash. We'll talk more about that in a second. If you make small changes to the input message, you want to have very large changes on the output, so that it's not like, if I change the second character here, I see just the second character on my output change. That's too easy, because then you could start figuring out and back calculating what happened. You also want something that's what they call collision resistant. Basically not feasible for two messages to create the same hash result. So just like when I was talking on the last slide, I had two different situations where I could get an O coming out. But I don't want to have the same hash result. Or if I had two messages that both started with the word how in it. Even if I used the same formula of the second letter, I would still get O for both those. So that's something that we don't want to have happen in cryptography. So we want something that's mutually exclusive. It's unique. It's like a unique stamp. So a different way of looking at this more technically is the hash of whatever we have in X. It could be data. It could be a file. It could be text. It could be transactions. Whatever it is in X, we don't want the hash of X equaling the hash of Y. So if we have a different input Y, if we hash that, we don't want those things to ever be equal to each other. And that's what collision resistance means, where you're going to get the same output for completely different inputs. That's probably the basic, best way to think about it. So you want to make sure that you cannot get the same output for two different inputs, or that you always your output is unique for each input. Now, how would you know if whether or not your algorithm was collision resistant or not? Well, you'd probably have to run your algorithm through all the different permutations. And actually, you really just have to put it a little bit over the middle point of how many different things. So you run 2 times the number of bits. Let's say you have a 8-bit system. A 2 to the 8 would be 256 times plus 1. Or sorry, 255 plus 1. That would give you 256 bit output, which means you'd have to run half of that number to know whether you're going to be having a collision or not. But if your number of bits is 256 bit, you'd have to run 2 to the 128 times, or just over half, to find a collision on average. Well, that's great, but how do we put that into terms that we can imagine how difficult that is? So let's put it in cosmic terms. If we had all of humankind's computers running hashes since the beginning of time, the odds that you'd find a collision using what Bitcoin uses, the SHA-256 hash function, all the way running until now, the chances of finding a collision would be infinitesimally small. In fact, on average, it would be 7.71 times 10 to the 17th known universe lifetimes. That's how many universe lifetimes from the dawn of our universe to now it would take just to find a collision. Those are pretty large numbers, and the likelihood that you're going to find a collision is extraordinarily rare, as you can imagine. Okay, so the hash then that Bitcoin uses is called the SHA-256, and it's also used for making addresses. It's used for, and we'll learn in a later lecture, building blocks and actually linking blocks together as well. Another one that's also used is the RIPEMD 160, particularly with making addresses, so they're formatted in a certain way. So let's say you have a public key that's generated. You take the SHA-256 of that key, then you take the RIPEMD 160 hash function of that SHA-256 key, and that gives you what we call a fingerprint. And so that is this message right here in the front, fingerprint. So this, think of this as like the hashed data, or the signature of that. We have a front base, the base, a hex base up here. So that becomes the front end of the data, base 58. And then we have our fingerprint data, which is there. Then we have, again, the SHA-256 of the fingerprint. So we take this fingerprint, we take the SHA-256 of that, and then again the SHA-256 of that result, and we take the first 4 bytes, and that becomes our checksum, which if you're used to anything in coding, when you send and receive message, a checksum is just to make sure that the data is correct. So you can take that checksum and make sure that that matches the data, because it's independently verifiable. And so that appends onto the back end. So this entire thing then is what we call an address. So, and this is what it looks like in 64 hexadecimal characters. Okay. Now, The other thing we use SHA-56 hashing for is to hash long messages. And why would we want to do this? Well, what's really cool and unique about this is we can take very long messages, break them up into parts. In this case, we're talking about breaking them up into 512 bits each. And we can hash each piece to get them down to 256. And then when we're done putting all those pieces together with an initialization vector to start, which is a random 256 number, and then so we hash the 512-bit message with the initial initialization vector, and then we get these little C pieces, which is a collision-free hash. And then we take that output, or that C, put that in and combine that with the next block that, again, is hashed, and then and so on for however many message blocks we need to put together. So in this way, this is called the Merkle down guard transform. We can convert any length of message into a fixed length collision resistant compression function. So in this way, we can take, and that's why we could take entire files and compress them down into a 256-bit hash that, again, is non-reversible. So another way of looking at it when we have several blocks. So now that we understand we can do this with any message, and it doesn't matter. Well, let's say instead of these being messages, let's say these are blocks of transactions. So we have a block 0, block 1, block however many. And we hash the block. That's just like hashing the message. And that's the output. And we do that with every block. And then once we have all these hashes, hash 0, 1 through n, it's just like all these C's. Then we, instead of doing them in series, we hash all of those together into, again, a 256 number that represents the hashing of all these hashes. A lot of hash talk here. So that's kind of an essence, and we'll look deeper into that in another lecture. But suffice it to say, what's the beauty about that hashing is, one, it's very difficult, if not impossible, to reverse it and figure out what the original was. But you can always recalculate forward to know to be able to do verifications. And you can get everything from any length down to a specific length, the 256 bit number. All right, so the last piece is the digital signatures. So for digital signatures, this is a little bit different process of where we're using the keys, both public and private, so that we can put a signature on a piece of data. And that key then is associated with a signer, a person, a program, something where it has to have a signature that's associated with that data. And so how do we do that? Well, for the signer, you take the data or the file or whatever it is, you do a hash function, and it doesn't have to be 256. There's lots of different hash functions that are used for this. And then once you have that hash of the data, that goes into what we call a signature algorithm. And the signature algorithm combines the hash of the data and the private and the signer's private key to come up with a unique signature. So that signature is mathematically tied and encoded with the data. So that's how those two things are linked. Now, once you have that, you can send that signature encoded data, and then you can parse out the data piece and run the hash function on that. And that should be equal to what the signer had put. And then you go to the signature, you run the verification algorithm on the other side. Now, this actually uses the signer's public key that you can actually send publicly. And so the algorithm then reveals the data again that gets hashed. And of course, again, if the hash data on the top end and the data is hashed on the other end, because they were able to pull off the signature off of it, if those are equal, then you know it's actually the same thing. And so you've verified that that is the signature on there. And so it can't be duplicated. Now, that was a lot of information packed into a small nutshell without getting overly technical, and we didn't get into any of the coding, of course. It's really the tip of of the cryptography iceberg. If you really want to dive into cryptography more, I really suggest you go to this tutorialspoint.com on cryptography, and they have a whole series of things that you can do on your own time and dive into any different types of topics of cryptography and really get versed in it. Wikipedia also has a myriad of different sources. There's the other links I also gave you in this lecture as well that talks about different aspects of different algorithms that are used, like the OpenSSL. That also shows a lot of the different algorithms that can be used, what are the pros and cons of different ones, and what are some of the weaknesses of some of them. So, all right, that's enough for this talk because that's quite a bit of time. So I think at that, I will see you in the next class. Take care.